Imagine you wake up one day and you can't remember anything. Not your name, not your family, not your friends, not your dreams, nothing. You have no idea who you are or what you're doing. You're just a blank slate. It sounds terrifying because memory is essential to our sense of self. Memory is a story of you. It's how you learn from the past, navigate the present, and plan for the future. It's how you connect with others, express yourself, and create meaning in your life. But what is memory exactly? How does it work? And why do we sometimes forget things and remember them differently? Memory isn't a single thing or a fixed location in the brain. It's a complex and dynamic process that involves multiple systems and stages. It can be divided into different types based on how long it lasts and what kind of information it stores. Sensory memory is the shortest and most basic type of memory. It holds sensory information from the environment for a fraction of a second before it fades away or gets transferred to a different type of memory. Sensory memory allows us to perceive the world as a continuous stream of stimuli rather than a series of disconnected snapshots. Contrary to our five senses, there are three kinds of sensory memory: iconic, echoic, and haptic. For example, when you see a flash of lightning, you retain a brief image of it in your iconic or visual memory. When you hear a sound, you keep a short echo of it in your echoic or auditory memory. And when you touch something, you have a fleeting impression of it in your haptic or touch memory. Sensory memory is mostly unconscious and automatic. We don't have much control over what we sense or how long we remember it. However, some sensory information can catch our attention and move to the next stage of memory, the short-term memory. Short-term memory is also known as active memory. It holds information that we are currently aware of or working with for a few seconds up to a few minutes before it gets forgotten or transferred to a different type of memory. Short-term memory has a limited capacity as it can only hold about 7 items at a time. You can visualize it as a temporary workspace where we can manipulate and process information for various purposes. When you read a sentence, you keep the words in your short-term memory until you understand their meaning. When you dial a phone number, you keep the digits in your short-term memory until you finish the call. Short-term memory is mostly conscious and voluntary. We can choose what we pay attention to and what we ignore. We may also use strategies to improve our short-term memory, such as grouping information into meaningful units or repeating information to ourselves. However, due to its voluntary being, it's the most vulnerable to interference and decay. When we get distracted by something else or don't repeat the information enough, we can lose it quickly. That's why we often forget things such as where we parked our car or what we had for lunch yesterday. To prevent information from fading away in short-term memory, we need to encode it into our long-term memory. Long-term memory is the most complex and durable type of memory. It holds information that we have learned and experienced over time for days, months, years, or even decades. Long-term memory has a practically unlimited capacity as it can store virtually infinite amounts of information. You could view it as some sort of vast library where we store and retrieve information for later use. When you recall your first kiss, you access your long-term memory, and when you solve a math problem, you also use your long-term memory and try to recall the specific formulas needed to solve your John buys 100 bananas problem. Long-term memory can then be further divided into two subtypes, implicit and explicit. Implicit memory, also known as unconscious memory, stores information that we don't have to consciously recall or declare, such as skills, habits, emotions, associations, and conditioning. Implicit memory is mostly acquired through repetition and practice, so you can regard it as riding a bike. You don't have to think about how you do it, you just do it automatically. When you tie your shoelaces, play an instrument, or feel scared by a loud noise, you rely on your implicit memory. This sort of memory is the most resistant to forgetting, as you can retain skills and habits for a long time, even if you don't use them frequently. However, implicit memory itself may still be influenced by factors such as mood, context, and priming. Explicit memory, also known as conscious memory, stores information that we have to consciously recall or declare, such as facts and events. Explicit memory is mostly acquired through attention and understanding. You can compare it with telling a story. You have to think about what to say and how to say it. When you recite the alphabet, you remember your birthday, or explain a concept, you use your explicit memory. Explicit memory itself can then be further divided into two subtypes, the semantic and episodic memory. Semantic memory is the memory of general knowledge. It stores information such as facts, concepts, words, and rules. Semantic memory is organized by meaning and categories. For example, when you know that Paris is the capital of France, that cats are mammals, or that 2 plus 2 equals 4. Semantic memory is often acquired through formal education and exposure to various sources of information. It's relatively stable and consistent, as we can recall facts and meanings regardless of when or where we learn them. However, semantic memory can also be heavily affected by errors and biases. We may confuse similar words or concepts, forget details or sources, or believe false or misleading information. Episodic memory is a memory of personal experiences. It stores information such as events, places, people, emotions, and sensations. Episodic memory is organized by time and context. Your episodic memory is at work when you remember what you did yesterday, where you went on vacation, or who you met at a party. Episodic memory is often acquired through direct involvement and participation in various situations. It's highly subjective and variable, as we can recall experiences differently depending on when or how we remember them. It may also be influenced by factors such as attention, emotion, motivation, and reconstruction. For example, we may pay more attention to some aspects of an event than others, feel more or less emotional about an event over time, have different reasons to remember or forget an event, or fill in the gaps or change the details of an event based on our expectations or beliefs. If you don't want to forget the books you've read or the things you've studied, you have to find a way to insert the information into your long-term memory. In order to do this, you will need two crucial things. Attention is the gateway to memory. If you don't focus on something, you can't remember it. Therefore, eliminating distractions can drastically improve the amount of information you'll retain from a study session. Repetition and review of information help transfer it from short-term memory to long-term memory. Reviewing information at increasing intervals of time, testing yourself on it, and relating it to other information you know will further strengthen its place in your long-term memory. Further improving your memory is possible with certain strategies and techniques. A common tactic is the use of mnemonics. They can be words, phrases, stories, or acronyms that represent information in a way that is more concise or easier to remember. You can think of it as compressing a file. The information takes up less space, but it also takes longer to decode or to remember. Your memory is strongly influenced by your emotions. If you're interested, curious, or excited about something, you're more likely to remember it. Therefore, finding ways to make your memory tasks enjoyable will make you more likely to remember them over long periods of time. Visualization or creating mental images can help you with this. It encodes information in both verbal and visual forms in your memory, which helps you create more vivid and distinctive memories that will be easier to remember than just plain old text. As you can see, memory isn't a simple or static phenomenon. It's a dynamic and creative process that involves multiple types and functions of memory. Memory isn't just a record of the past. It's also a construction of the present and a projection of the future. Memory is a story of you, but it's not a fixed or final story. It's a story that changes and evolves as you do. It's a story that reflects who you are and who you want to be. So next time you remember something, don't just take it for granted. Appreciate the complexity and wonder of your memory.